Let's see what are the important things we need to learn it from group 17. Group 17, we need to discuss about their elements, the physical properties, chemical properties of chlorine mainly. So see, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, these are the group elements and all of them are non-metals, while astatine is a radioactive and also a metalloid. Okay. Next. Electronic configuration wise, if you look at it, it is NS2 and NP5. You will see this had more non-metal character and non-metallic character will decrease down the group. As it reaches to astatine, it will become more metallic. Physical properties wise, if you look at fluorine, chlorine are gases while bromine is liquid and iodine is solid. Fluorine is a pale yellow color gas. Chlorine is a greenish yellow color gas. Bromine is red liquid and iodine is, black solid in a solid form. Next, if you see with increase in the size of X2, the physical state changes from gas to liquid. Okay. And solid, usually whenever they are solid, they have only London dispersion forces. Right? Because as you go down the group, why they are becoming more solid is the size is increasing. Iodine is bigger in size. Because it is bigger in size, it can have more dispersion of electrons, which means it can give better London forces. Okay. Next, you see iodine conducts electricity to a very small extent in solid state and liquid state. Okay. And its conductivity increases on increasing temperature. So the movement of electrons in a crystalline form will be easier in iodine. So therefore, it will start conducting electricity. In gaseous state, if you observe, fluorine is a pale yellow color gas. Chlorine is greenish yellow. Bromine is reddish brown. And iodine is violet. Now the color of this halides, X2, is mainly due to the homo-lumo transition. Let me remind you, when it comes to fluorine, the last electrons would be present in pi star 2px and pi star 2py. And sigma star 2pz will have zero electrons in here, which means this is the homo orbital of fluorine and this is the lumo orbital of fluorine. Okay. Now, between when it comes to energy levels, if you recall the Ofbos principle also, as you go away from the nucleus, the difference in the energy keeps decreasing, right? The same logic can be applied here that the energy difference between this HOMO and LUMO is relatively more as compared to what you have it in chlorine, bromine or iodine. Because the difference is more in fluorine, it usually requires a larger frequency or smaller wavelength radiations, so that the electron can excite from HOMO to LUMO. Got it? Hence, it would usually absorb more frequency radiations or less lambda radiations like violet or blue. These are the radiations which they absorb. And which means the reflected or the transmitted light would be more of pale colors like yellow towards red. That would be the colors which you will see. Got it? So this is the issue with the fluorine. Now, if you see the chlorine, relatively it is less, and bromine and iodine, it will be far less. So iodine usually absorbs, larger wavelengths, and the energy which is dissipate will be with a smaller wavelength, which means energy would be more in a transmission line. So what we observe, the observed radiations would be having more frequency. That's why you will see more of violet color when it is from iodine. Clear, students? So remember this terminology that this is because of homo-lumo transition. See the atomic size. From fluorine towards iodine, the atomic size increases. As you go down the group, shells are increasing, atomic size increases. Remember, Z effective as we go down the group usually remains constant. It is only the shells which are increasing, because of which the size increases. The next factor, if you look at it, is ionization energy. The ionization energy has a very regular trend. Down the group, size is increasing. So it's more easier to remove an electron compared to what we will get in fluorine. Electron gain enthalpy. Usually fluorine is supposed to be most, but because of small size and strong electronic repulsions, chlorine would have more electron gain enthalpy, which means it will release more amount of energy as compared to that of fluorine. Melting point and boiling point down the group, you know, always increases because of the molar mass factor as well as the van der Waal interactions. So iodine is better than bromine, chlorine and fluorine. This is an important, trend here. If it comes to bond dissociation energy, then we expect fluorine to be most because of the smaller size. But unfortunately, smaller the size and more lone pairs are present on both the fluorines, it will give more repulsion also. Although the bond length is smaller, they will have more repulsions here. So due to more repulsions, they will prefer to break down very easily. Okay, so bond dissociation energy is lesser for fluorine as what we expect. But if you compare the bond length, it is still the smallest and iodine has the largest bond length. Therefore, the order to be very well remembered, students, chlorine, bromine, fluorine, and then comes iodine. Okay. See the oxidizing power now. See, oxidizing power mainly depends on reduction potential. And reduction potential depends upon all the factors. Like if you take fluorine, for instance, from the gas, you're supposed to, you know, break it into ions. So first it will become 2F. From there, you have to give electrons here. Okay. Let's say if I take half of F2, so first it should become F. So for that, we require some energy, which is bond dissociation energy. And from there, we are supposed to provide an electron so that it can release energy. And this is still in gaseous state. And from there, you have to convert that into an aqueous ion. Okay. And that is how we will have delta H of the reaction from fluorine F2 to F minus aqueous. Now, the important point here is from gaseous to aqueous, we will have hydration energy. In the case of fluorine, right, beta, bond dissociation energy is comparable to other halogens. Electron affinity is also pretty much comparable, correct? But it is the hydration which is very, very high because of its smaller size. And this drastically bring that fluorine towards F minus. So that makes this reaction, you know, more tending towards the forward direction, which means towards the reduction side. It will always undergo reduction. So, and reduction potential always depends upon the magnitude, depends upon the delta H of the reaction magnitude. More the negative value of delta H reaction, more is the reduction potential. So, which will be the highest for fluorine, you know, and it is mainly because of the hydration factor. Very high hydration for fluorine. Okay. So fluorine would be greater than chlorine, bromine, and iodine. Okay. Which means if you see the reduction potentials also, the highest reduction potential is for fluorine only, isn't it? Which means fluorine can easily oxidize any halogens like Cl minus, it can oxidize to Cl2. Khud F minus ban jayega. Br minus, if you react with Cl2, Br minus can be oxidized to Br2. And if you see I2 will be oxidized to IO3 minus, considering ClO3 minus getting reduced to Cl2. BrO3 minus will get reduced to Br2, while iodine get oxidized to IO3. If you see the oxidizing potential or oxidizing nature, or oxidizing power, I would write oxidizing power. And if you compare these three, chlorine, iodine, and chloride, ClO3 minus. Okay, I forgot one more, Br2. In that case, chlorine would be more than bromine, then iodine, then ClO3 minus. Okay. Here, everybody.
Yes, sir.
Next. See the oxidation states. Fluorine always exhibits only one oxidation state, which is minus one. That is the most electronegative element and has the strongest oxidizing potential. Chlorine, bromine, iodide can show right from minus one to plus seven with various oxidation states. See, chlorine and bromine shows plus four and plus six, but for bromine, plus four is highly unstable. Although BrO2 is formed, it easily disproportionates. So BrO4, I have written it here. It will disproportionate to BrO and BrO3. Correct? So therefore, bromine easily undergoes disproportionation. So bromine does not show higher oxidation state, and it's rare and known as middle row anomaly. So even if you check about plus six oxidation state, bromine will again reduce itself to plus two or plus three, maximum plus one, minus one. These are the oxidation state bromine exhibits. So the higher oxidation states of bromine are usually not stable. Okay, this is called middle row anomaly. See, middle row anomaly is with regards to the fourth period beta. In the fourth period, like gallium, germanium, arsenic, correct, and selenium, bromine, they usually do not show higher oxidation state easily. Reason being, they were just filled up with 3D electrons. Their 3D electrons are completely filled. So not all electrons will participate easily, and their ionizations are relatively high. Okay. Coming to the next point, how these halogens react with aqueous solutions. So with water, if you take fluorine, add it to water, immediately fluorine will undergo reduction to HF and H2O will undergo oxidation to give O2. Okay. And depending upon how much fluoride you are adding, right, if you had concentrated F2, it would even give sufficient amount of O3 also. So O3 can be isolated from this solution. Next, chlorine, Cl2, if you add it to water, it will get reduced to HCl. And this part will become HOCl. So it is not the oxygen which is getting oxidized, it is the chlorine itself which is undergoing disproportionation. So it will give HCl with oxidation state minus one on it and plus one here. Okay. So HOCl, if you keep it for long standing, then it will lose the oxygen. Okay. Bacteria to oxidize them, or what we call it, bleaching them. That's why we normally use chlorine water as a bleaching agent, in swimming pools. Okay. So where we add chlorine to water, which will act like a bleaching agent. Next. Bromine, if you add it to water, will give you HBr and HOBr, while iodide directly does not react with water. And if you see the solubility of halides, fluorine is more soluble than chlorine, bromine, and iodine is hardly soluble. Clear? So reaction with water, I hope all of you understood.
Yes.
See, reaction with NaOH. This is a very, very important reaction in this topic. And the same thing we have repeated in group one also, where we were preparing NaOH and its reaction. Fluorine, if you react with NaOH in a cold and dilute solution, we will see this as NaF, where fluorine got reduced, and oxygen is getting oxidized here to form OF2, and remaining will be water. And if you take concentrated and hot, instead of forming OF2, it will only form O2. Okay, here oxidation state is plus 2. Here, oxidation state is zero. So, in cold and sorry, in concentrated and hot, it will go up to zero. Cold and dilute, it will show oxidation state of plus two. While on the other halogens, like chlorine, bromine, or iodine, they cannot oxidize oxygen. So they themselves will undergo oxidation, which is undergoing disproportionation in this case. So if you take cold and dilute, halogens will become minus one and plus one. While if you take hot and concentrated, they will become minus one and plus five. So they will become minus five and plus five. So that's how all halogens excluding fluorine, they would react this way with NaOH. I hope you guys remember that. Next. Reactions with other metals and non-metals. If you see, first we'll discuss with the non-metals. Boron plus X2 will become BX3. Phosphorus plus X2 will become PX3. If you add excess, it will go even up to PX5 except iodine that we have seen in group 15. Sulfur with fluorine will go up to SF4. If you provide excess, it will become SF6. If you treat with chlorine, it will become S2Cl2 and SCl4. While Br2, it will only become S2Br2. SBr4 does not exist. Again, here, because of the repulsions from increasing size of bromine, they would exist mostly as S2Br2. Okay. Next, see the reactions with metals. Any metal, if you react with fluorine, there is a high chance it will form metal fluorides. Got it? Even if you take gold also, gold will undergo oxidation in the presence of fluorine to give this. Whether it is platinum also, it will undergo fluorination. Okay. Next, chlorine and bromine, if you react with any of these metals, correct, they will form metal chloride and metal bromides, but the reaction is relatively slow. Iodide will also make the reaction except noble metals. Noble metals are these, right? So they don't react directly. So gold, platinum, iridium, osmium, they do not react very easily. Next, see the hydride parts. We have four hydrides, HF, HCl, HBr, and HI. Bond dissociation energy, if you take for any hydride of any group, it will always decreases down the way, because bond dissociation energy will only depend upon the bond length in this case. Because down the group, always the bond length increases, it becomes more easier to break the bond. So HF will be having more bond energy than HCl, HBr, and HI. Acidic character wise, if you look at it, in all the hydrides of any group, acidic character increases down the group. Okay. Again, it can be explained based on the bond dissociation energy, because as you add it to water, it can break very easily to give H+. Reducing character, again, similar to all other groups also, iodides will have more reducing nature compared to other hydrides. Thermal stability depends upon bond dissociation energy. Again, more bond dissociation energy, more thermal stability. Delta H vaporization, that also depends upon hydrogen bonding. So you would see HF will have very strong hydrogen bonding, but as you come out for HI, HBr, and HCl, here, HI will have more molar mass now, and hydrogen bonding is not very prominent for iodides, bromides, and chlorides. So, HF will have high delta H vaporization. Melting point, between these two, because melting point is all about converting solid form to, liquid form. In that case, hydrogen bonding is not the important characteristic there. Molar mass, okay, and the arrangement, that will make an impact. So HI will have more molar mass, and that will dominate over HF, correct, as compared to HBr and HCl. But if it comes to boiling point, so remember this one exception here, how the melting point is. When it comes to boiling point, it is the hydrogen bonding which is highly dominant in these cases. So HF will be more than HI, HBr, and HCl. Dipole moment. Dipole moment depends on two characteristics, if you recall. I mean, two parameters. One is the distance and the other one is the charge. Okay. The charge developed in HF is highly dominant as compared to the smaller bond length. Okay. And HCl will have sufficiently both of them, but not as much as that of HF. So HF will have more dipole moment than HCl, HBr and HI. Why I'm saying this or emphasizing this is because when you do the same thing with CH3Cl, that would be more than CH3F, which is more than CH3Br, which is more than CH3I. So in this case, right, between carbon and chlorine, if you compare, then the charge developed, although it is more in fluorine, the distance makes a lot of difference here. So that's why CH3Cl will have more dipole moment than CH3F. So that's why I'm emphasizing on that point. But if it comes to HF, it is a regular trend only. So HF will have more dipole moment than HCl. Clear? Now, let us see about the compounds by compound, first being HF. Typically, HF is prepared mostly from, you know, fluoride salts like CaF2, or even you can get it from BaF2 also. CaF2, if you react with concentrated H2SO4, HF will come out as vapors and calcium sulfate will form precipitate. Now, HF, whether it is in liquid state or a solid state, Nabita, they will be in a zigzag fashion. And very importantly, the fluorine should always be at the corners. The reason being, if it is at the center here, correct, the lone pairs will be always on the other side, which will hinder the hydrogen bonding to happen. Therefore, here, this will be much more directed. The lone pairs are much more directed for hydrogen bonding to the next layer. So therefore, here, these lone pairs which are present will be directed this side. And the one of the lone pair will be directed so that this side, it can form a hydrogen bonding. And here also, you can see there is HF bond, one lone pair here and two other lone pairs are directed this way. So you can see this way, it can easily direct for better hydrogen bonding. Here, everybody. That's why, remember, this was one of the JE question earlier. Like, where do we have fluorides? At the corners or at the centers? So fluoride should be at the corners, hydrogens will be at the centers. Okay. HF can exist as a monomeric form, but usually that happens at very high temperature. It can exist as a dimer or also cyclic hexameric form, depending upon various temperatures. But the idea is it can exist in monomer form, dimer form, or cyclic hexameric form also. We have learned this in group 14 that we should not be storing fluorine in glass containers, because HF, you know, hydrogen fluoride will immediately react with SiO2, would form SiO4. This is what we call it as etching of glass. And then on hydrolysis, SiF4 can easily form a colorless, soluble, you know, acid, which we call it as fluorosilicic acid. Okay. So it's not recommended to keep fluorides, hydrogen fluorides in silica, SiO2. Next. HF has a unique property to form salts with F- because of the strong hydrogen bonding. The bond strength is almost equal to a covalent bond between hydrogen and bromine. So if you see iodine, whatever the bond strength we have, it is almost equivalent to that of fluorine and hydrogen bond. Hydrogen bonding between these two. That's why if you come across F-, that will attract hydrogen so strongly that it will make a complete compound only. Like K+ and HF2- forms a crystalline salt. Here, everybody. And HF has more K value in concentrated solutions, correct? In a concentrated form in aqueous solutions. Why? See, if you take HF and add it to water, normally what we see that it will have some K1 value. It will give H3O+ and F-. This is normal K1 value. But if you have excess, right, correct, HF, whatever F minus is forming, that F minus will also again react with HF to form HF2 minus. You know? Because it has this unique property of forming salt, it can form HF2 minus. So now, if I take 2 moles of HF in water, considering it is concentrated, then we can get H3O plus HF2 minus. And this will be the new Ka2, which will be greater than Ka1. Okay. So, if you put it in a concentrated form for HF, it will give you more acidic strength. I guess that is clear, everybody. Right. So, this is the information on HF beta. Let us see about HCl. HCl, preparation-wise, if you look at it, NaCl reacted with concentrated H2SO4 will form NaHSO4, releasing HCl. And if you do that at higher temperature, more and more vapors will be forming and it becomes more easier for the reaction to take place. And we will get HCl vapors out of it. See, HCl is a colorless, pungent, smelling gas. Okay. It does form white fumes on reacting with ammonia. So you know that, like if you have HCl plus NH3, both these vapors will form white dense fumes of ammonium chloride. It can be dissolved in platinum gold, you know, with some concentrated HNO3 taken. But that should be taken in 3:1 ratio, which we call it as aqua regia. So if you take aqua regia, platinum gold can also be dissolved in HCl. Now that is about HCl. Now let's see about the oxides. When it comes to oxides, fluorine, chlorine, bromine, iodine, all of them will form various types of oxides. Fluorine, only two types, OF2 and O2F2. While if you look at for chlorine, chlorine forms Cl2O, ClO2, Cl2O6, Cl2O7. All these type of oxides are formed. Bromine, BrO2, BrO2, Br2O, BrO3 and Br3O8. So, wherever I put the star mark, they all have at least one unpaired electron present with it, and that will make them paramagnetic in nature. Okay. Iodine does not form simple oxides. They will form higher oxidation oxides, which includes I2O5 and I2O7. Okay. There are two ionic oxides which are forming. See, I4O9 and I2O4. The idea here is one of the iodide here is I plus 3. And it is making an ionic contact with IO3 minus. Similarly, I2O4, here we have IO plus as one of the ion making an ionic contact with IO3 minus. Okay. Learn this too. This is important. What are ionic oxides? Okay. And bromide Br3O8, this is the structure, students. And you can see the central bromine has one unpaired electron because it has six bonds, four here, five and six here. So there is one electron left. Okay. Now, usually we always see that ClO2 has an unpaired electron. Then it is why it is not dimerizing. While ClO3 has an unpaired electron, it went for dimerization to form Cl2O6. See, whenever a dimer is happening, which means the electron is localized. But in ClO2, electron is always in a delocalized form. Correct? So here, the electron is with this oxygen. It has a lone pair. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So these are six electrons here. Okay. So it has two bonds here. So 4, 5, this is 2 and 2, 4. And one more double bond here, 5, 6. This is how it is. And that single electron on oxygen, you know, keeps moving here and here. Right? So it will keep moving as a bond here towards this side. So it will keep making this bond here. So it will make more like a triple bond here and a single bond here. And again from here, it will make triple bond here and a single bond here. So the electron, sorry. I'm talking about ClO3. My mistake. Here we have pair and pair, pair, and a dot here. Sorry. Okay. So in ClO2, if you observe, oxygen is completing its octet. Here, oxygen is completing its octet. So they have no need to take this single electron. But if you take ClO3 here, so double bond O, and then we have single bond oxygen here. So it has 5 electrons present here, correct? And a lone pair present on chlorine. Okay. So we have this way. And if you see, there is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 electron shared here. And this oxygen is the one, you know, where the lone pair present on these oxygens, correct? They will start supporting like a triple bond so that the double bond can, so that this dative bond can be formed here. One second. Show that dative bond, double bond here. Yeah, like this. So the dative bond can be formed here. So 4 and 4 and 5, 6 electrons, correct? Now the single electron which is present, right? The single electron has been identified to keep moving around these oxygens. Got it? Clear? Okay. Let's take one second. Because this is not moving. I need to have a dimer formation, right? Cl double bond O, dative bond O, and dot. Now, because octet is complete here, and this is localized electron, it would form a dimer, giving this double bond O, dative bond O, chlorine, double bond O, dative bond O. Sorry. So this will form a dimer. And when it comes to ClO2, we'll have double bond O here with 3 electrons and 2 electrons here with the lone pair. So we have 2 here, 3 here, and 2 electrons here. So 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. This way, electrons are present here. Right. It's a 3 electron bond. Sorry. And this electron will keep moving around, you know, this side ones and the other side ones. This lone pair here with double bond O, chlorine with the lone pair here, and oxygen. So because this electron is moving around both the oxygens, it is unavailable at chlorine. That's why this does not undergo dimerization. Okay. Yeah, that's what I wanted to explain here. Next, the same logic applies to these bromides. Wherever there are dots present on bromides, they are not dimerizing. See the stability. Between these oxides, iodides which are making ionic oxides, right? They are very stable because they will form a strong ionic bonds here. So you would see ionic iodides will be more stable compared to the chlorine oxides compared to that of bromine oxides. The oxides of chlorine are not prepared by oxidation of chlorine. Okay, which means if you try to react chlorine with O2 and you are expecting some Cl2, ClO2, Cl2O5 form, the reaction is, you know, non-spontaneous. So they are not usually made by direct reaction with oxygen. They are made by, you know, different acids forming first. Acids, then dehydration. For example, ClO2. We'll check out with this oxides here now. If you take ClO2, ClO2 adding to water will give you HOCl, okay, which is clearly confirming that it is an anhydrate of hypochlorous acid, isn't it? So if you get hypochlorous acid, where did we get that? If you remember earlier, we got that from here. So when we reacted with water, correct? So if you take chlorine and react with HCl and HOCl to give HCl and HOCl, we got HOCl there. So if you take that HOCl here and heat it, if you take an HOCl and heat it, we will definitely get Cl2O and H2O because HOCl is an anhydride. So most of the chlorine oxides are prepared by their acids beta. So we make an acid either by making a reaction with a base or water. And once you get that acid, we heat it. On heating it, we'll get different oxides. Okay. Now you can see ClO2 is an oxidizing agent. And as an example, you can see ClO2, when you react with ammonia, it will release N2 gas. Chlorine get reduced to HCl, forming water. Okay. So this is a very good oxidizing agent, Cl2O. ClO2, you can see that structure now. I think now you'll be able to understand why I wrote that 3 electrons here. So this dot is the one which will keep moving around this oxygens, right? So you would have this electron moving around these two, as well as this is one of the canonicals present. Now in this case, oxygen is moving. So since it is a delocalized electron, although it is an odd electron, it will not undergo dimerization. So ClO2 exists the way it is. It is a yellow color gas. It does not dimerize. And ClO2 plus water, if you add it, right, it will give you HClO3 and HClO2. Take 2 moles of that. Which means this is a mixed anhydride. Very important question. Okay. So ClO2 is a mixed anhydride. Correct. And it will give HClO3 and HClO2. Next, look out for Cl2O6. Cl2O6 is a red color liquid. It's a red color liquid. And Cl2O6 is also a mixed anhydride, which on reacting with water, you'll get HClO3 and HClO4. And I showed you here the structure of ClO3. It is localized. Okay, since it is localized, it is undergoing dimerization to form Cl2O6. Okay. Last one, Cl2O7 is a colorless liquid. It is a colorless liquid, and Cl2O7, it is a simple anhydride of HClO4, because on adding water, you'll only get HClO4. And HClO4, if you treat with P4O10, right, yahan se pura water hata dega, and you'll get Cl2O7 and HPO3. These are simple reactions for this oxides as well as acids. Ye dono hi cover ho gaya dekho. Acids ke reaction bhi, or rather dehydration reaction, as well as hydration reactions of this acid. Clear everybody? Okay. Now we'll look at into oxo acids. Give me a second. We'll be back. Yeah, let's see further. Now, when it comes to oxyacids, we saw that HOCl, HClO2, HClO3, and HClO4. These are the acids formed by chlorine. Whenever we have +1 oxidation state, we call it as hypo, +3. This is always hypo plus us acid. But here it is only us acid. And when you have +5 oxidation state, it is ic acid. Any +7 state will always start with per and end with ic. So this is perchloric acid. Now look at the acidic strength. HOCl, HOBr, HOI, if you compare, then HOCl is better acid. Once you remove H+ out of it, we will get this as OCl. In OCl, the lone pair present on oxygen can make a backbonding with chlorine and give an overlapping of 2p and 3p kind, and a pi bond can be formed here, and which makes it very stable Hence, HOCl is more acidic. And as you compare to OBr and OI, so 2P, 3P is a better overlapping than 2P, 4D and 2P, sorry, no, this is 3D, not 3P, my mistake, 3D. So 2P, 3D is a better overlapping compared to 2P, 4D and 2P, 5D. So that's why the HOCl part, chlorous acid, hypochlorous acid is more acidic. And similarly, if you compare HClO3, HBrO3 and HiO3, okay, same problem here also. ClO3 minus will give a better overlapping of 2P and 3D. Hence, HClO3 is more acidic. And if you compare HClO4, HBrO4 and HiO4, then HClO4 is more acidic. And within this molecule, if you check out the acidic cases, HOCl, HClO2, HClO3 and HClO4, then HClO4 is much more acidic because that would have more resonating structures in their anions. That is, ClO4 minus will have more equivalent resonating structures compared to ClO3 minus, ClO2 minus and OCl. Thermal stability wise, if you look at it, higher oxidation state, stronger is the covalent bond. So it will require more energy to break. Therefore, you will see normally HClO4, which has high bond order, okay, and strong and more covalent strength. So that will have more thermal stability compared to that of HClO3, HClO2, and HOCl. Oxidizing nature, this is a very important case because this looks exactly opposite than the expected ones. Okay. Normally, what we expect is that HClO4, which is at a higher oxidation state, usually act like a good oxidizing agent, isn't it? Because from higher oxidation, they will come to lower oxidation. But unfortunately here, HOCl will give you better oxidizing nature compared to HClO2, HClO3 and HClO4. This can be explained with the fact that as soon as you try to oxidize, because of their acidic nature, they will release H+ and expect to exist as ClO4, ClO-. And stability wise, if you look, ClO4- is more stable. Okay. Hence, this does not give a lot of oxygens out, while this can give nascent oxygens better compared to that of ClO2-, ClO3- and ClO4-. Here, everybody. So this can give nascent oxygen at a much better rate compared to HClO2, HClO3, and HClO4. Hence the oxidizing nature. Okay, this has been asked in the very recent JE exam. So learn it. Last thing. Just like chloric acids, we will also have iodine acids, out of which HiO4 acid is known as periodic acid, which usually exists as a hydrated form as HiO4.2H2. That was once mentioned. Coming to interhalogens, that means one halogen connected with the other halogen, if you look at it, XX dash, that is only 1:1 ratio of the halogens. Next, XX3 dash, 1:3, here it is 1:5 and 1:7. 1:1 compounds, you will see CLF, BRF, IF, then BRCL, ICL, and finally IBR. Okay, so these are the 1:1 ones which are forming. Next, if you compare three of them, CLF3, BRF3, IF3 are forming, and ICL3 is forming, and ICL3 usually undergoes dimerization. Next, CLF5, BRF5, and IF5 are forming. And finally, 7, only IF7 is forming. So I think this is one easy way to remember, is that you can see fluorides, all of them are forming, isn't it? Fluorides, all of them are forming. Chlorides, you know, first case, you know, bromine and iodine both will form. And second case, you will see only iodine will form chlorides, correct? And the first case, bromide is the one which exists. So this is a complete same table as been given in NCERT also. Unfortunately, this for mains, they are asking colors. And these colors were distinctly mentioned in the table. So learn the colors, especially the colors which I ticked here. Got it? See, first one, IF7, colorless. Or the better way to remember is this. The first series, all of them are colorless. I think that is more easier way to remember, right? So all of them are colorless. The other series which you can remember is the phi one. All phi types are colorless. Whenever you have phi ones, they are all colorless. Got it? And now, when it comes to BRF3, it is colored. This is colored, which is yellow. And finally, ICL3 twice, this is orange. And BRCL is red color, red brown, ICL is red, and IBR is black. Okay, so these four are the ones which are usually asked most of the time. So learn the colors of these four which I ticked. Done, everybody? Now come to the structures. CLF3, first one, CLF3. CLF3, chlorine being a central atom. Fluorines, we expected hybridization, hybridization is sp3, and expected structure is trigonal bipyramidal. But in the trigonal bipyramidal, you know that on the axial direction we will keep lone pairs, equatorial directions we will keep more electronegative elements. But because of this lone pair, they will have repulsions, and now it looks like a bent T shape like this. This is the bent T shape. Okay, same logic applies to BRF3 also. Now between fluorine, chlorine and fluorine, we are expecting 90 degrees angle, but because of the bent, you know, the angle will decrease. So here we have alpha 1 angle, and bromine, if you look at it, BRF3, that angle would be, you know, even more smaller, because bromine is a bigger size atom, so it can let fluorine comes closer. So therefore, if you compare alpha 1 and alpha 2 bond angle, alpha 1 is greater than that of alpha 2. Okay. 2010, there was one question asked, like how many number of 90 degree groups are present in this one? Once it was asked for BRF5 and once it was asked for CLF3. See, 90 degrees is not existing anymore. Because of the bend, that's why the answer is zero for it. See the same case with BRFI also. The hybridization is sp3d, but because of one of the lone pair, the shape is square pyramidal, and because of this lone pair, it will start, you know, repelling to the surface. So instead of staying like this, they'll start bending. So there is no more 90 degrees angle left here. So remember it like an important point. Okay, no 90 degree bond angles present. In case of BRFI. IF7, you know, expected hybridization is sp3d3, and expected geometry is pentagonal bipyramidal, and it will exist like pentagonal bipyramidal only. If you take ICL3, which will undergo dimerization, after dimerization you will have iodine at sp3d2, and this also, both the iodines at sp3d2. If it is sp3d2, you can see this is a plane, and then again a plane, and again a plane. So what we are getting is a square planar structure. This is only one of the examples where a dimer is forming a planar surface. Usually every time a dimer is formed, we usually get always, you know, a tetrahedral kind of a structure, but this is one of the cases where you will see square planar forming, square planar shape forming. Okay, now reaction wise if you look at it, the more electronegative halogen, this one, X dash, is more electronegative compared to that of X, that will always come out as acid. It will always come out as acid. So HX dash, HX dash in all of the cases. Rest all will undergo hydration to give the respective oxy acids. They all will give us respective oxy acids. Okay, that's how the hydrolysis happens for them. Next, see about polyhalogens. So polyhalides, if you look at it, I2 reacting with I minus, it will give you I3 minus. And some forms of Cl3 minus and Br3 minus and F3 minus never forms here. Stability if you look at it, I3 minus is much more stable than Br3 minus than Cl3 minus, because I3 minus will have, hold better lone pair repulsions compared to Br3 minus or Cl3 minus. Molecular stability, if you look at it, CsI3 is better stable than KI3 than NaI3. So these are the things we need to learn it from polyhalides. I guess this is clear, everybody. Okay.
Yes, sir.